Hello all, hope you are doing good. I welcome you all to the sixth lecture in this EE614. The last time we met, we discussed about the origin of band gaps in a semiconductor. We discussed that you have some density of states, it is not infinite, it is some discrete finite density of states. And we discussed the case of an intrinsic semiconductor. Intrinsic semiconductor is one which has equal number of electrons and holes, and then we saw that it has the density Ni as the number of electrons can be expressed simply as the effective density of states in the conduction band into e power EF. EF is called the Fermi level or the chemical potential minus EC, the energy of the conduction band, by kT. K being the Boltzmann constant and T being the temperature. In the similar way, we can also determine the number of holes in the intrinsic case to be NV, be the effective density of states of the valence band into E power E valence band E Fermi level by kT. Right? We derived these expressions, and then we saw that this product Ni into Pi is Ni and Pi are the same in an intrinsic semiconductor. We call it Ni square is Nc Nv e power minus Eg by kT, right? And Nc and Nv as we saw before, and hence this the number of carriers in the intrinsic case depends only on the band gap and the temperature. So basically it depends upon the material and the temperature characteristics and does not depend on any other parameter. So this being the case for an intrinsic semiconductor, we go to this topic of today's discussion, which is an extrinsic semiconductor. So we saw in the intrinsic case, you always have the number of electrons to be same as the number of holes, right? So in the extrinsic case, or there will be some situations where you want to have one carrier density higher than the other. So what you do in such situations is what is called as doping. So you add some foreign atoms into the semiconductor and change the density of carriers. So let us say that we have our band structure as we saw before, right? We have this energy gap Eg, there could be any bands, right? So what happens is, if you add atoms such that it has energy levels in between the band gap, right, somewhere like this, if it has something like this, now these energy levels can exchange electrons between the bands. So this being the conduction band, this being the valence band, right? It will exchange electrons between the conduction and valence band, and they become charged and then contribute to carrier densities, right? So if we have an external atom, the impurity that you have added close to the conduction band, we call this the donor. And if you have the impurity atom which is close to the valence band, we call this the acceptor, right? Of course, you know these things before, right? So what happens is, the donor donates an electron to the conduction band and becomes positively charged, and the acceptor takes an electron from the valence band and becomes negatively charged, right? So this is what happens when it actually exchanges the carrier densities. At this point, let us stop and then go and look at most commonly used acceptors and donors, so that we have a better feel about what we are talking about, right? So, I'm sorry about the quality of this image. This is taken from SMZ, from Wiley Publishing. It's one of the references that we have. So here, we have several semiconductors. The top one is germanium. Then we have silicon. Then we have gallium arsenide, and you can see the band gap being aligned, right? Germanium having some 0.66, silicon being 1.12, and gallium arsenide being 1.14 EV. It is instructive to have a mental note of these numbers because this is often used in your research and many places in the industry and so on. Right? So for germanium, you have dopants like lithium. You have lithium, which has the energy level very close to the conduction band. Boron, energy level very close to the valence band. Similarly, aluminum, very close to the valence band. Indium, zinc, chromium, all these guys trying to act as an acceptor. Similarly, lithium, antimony, phosphorus, arsenic, sulfur, all these guys acting as a donor. Silicon also has similar properties. Gallium arsenide is interesting because you can see silicon, right, is both an acceptor and a donor. Right? Can you think about why? Similar the case is germanium. It has both acceptor and donor levels, which are very close to the conduction valence band. It comes because of the fact that gallium arsenide is a group 3-5 semiconductor. So if silicon replaces the gallium, then it acts as a donor. And if it replaces an arsenic, it acts as an acceptor, right? So basically, it depends upon the valency. Gallium has a valency of 3, arsenic has a valency of 5, depending upon silicon has 4, as we previously saw. It depends on what it replaces to actually form these levels, right? So, given that we have these levels and their positions in the gap, let us go back to our previous discussion and then see that if we have Na as the number of impurity that you added, the number of actually ionized impurity that you have at any time will be, sorry, this is an acceptor, right? So basically it has to be negative. This Na divided by 1 plus Ga e power e. We will, without deriving this formula completely, we will just discuss as to why this this relationship comes up, right? So basically, the number of ionized acceptor will be proportional to the number of acceptors that you actually put there, right? And it also depends upon the degeneracy of the holes, in the sense that we know that certain semiconductors, basically silicon and germanium, have degenerate hole bands, right? So we call this the heavy hole, we call this the light hole, depending upon the this is the heavy hole, this is light hole, depending upon the slope, right? And it depends. So basically the number of acceptor, ionized acceptors, basically the ionized, so this is the acceptor level, right? For it to be acceptor, for it to be ionized, you can see that this energy level has to be occupied, and the probability of this energy level, so the probability of this energy level to be occupied is the F of E. This is the Fermi Dirac distribution, right? And this is 1 by 1 plus E power E minus EF by KT, correct? And that's what you see here. So basically it is proportional to the number of acceptor atoms that you have put, and the Fermi probability of that particular acceptor level to be occupied. If this level has a higher probability of being occupied, you can see that the electron in the valence band will immediately jump to this acceptor level, forming you a hole and giving you the ionized acceptor. The same relationship for the donor is written as Nd by 1 plus Gb e power EF minus E donor by KT. Now, it's easy to explain this one because we saw the same thing here, right? So for the donor to be ionized, you have to see that this particular level, that the donor level should be vacant, should have a hole, right? If this donor level has the probability to have a hole, the electron would have jumped from this level to the conduction band. And the probability for this to be a hole is 1 minus f of e. And this will come out to be 1 by 1 plus e power ef minus e by kt. If you evaluate this expression, you will get this. And you can see that it is similar. And you know that the conduction band is usually a single band, and it can take two spins. So typically GB happens to be 2 and GA happens to be 4, right? So now that we have the expressions for the ionized acceptors and donors, now let us go and take a look at the plot that we have seen before. I'm sure you guys must have seen this plot many times before, and it is asked in many places, right? You have dealt with this. I'm seeing that this is an interesting problem asked in most interviews and so on and so forth. So this is very important plot. It plots the electron density. This is taken for electron. The same thing can be written for holes as well. Just for now, it's for electrons versus temperature. Right? I am actually going to write the expression here so that we can refer to this expression when we discuss. So Nd plus is actually Nd 1 plus Gd, being the degeneracy. So we are not talking about the energy level per se here, but then we are talking more about the temperature. Right, so what happens is, let us go from the right. So when you have very low temperature, such that 1 by T is a very high value, at very low temperatures, you can see that the exponent value is very large, because it comes in 1 by the, it comes as a denominator of the exponent. So if this denominator is very large, you can see that Nd value should be very low. So at very high temperatures, you have Nd plus much smaller than Nd, right? Giving you the actual freezer. So that's the reason why you have a freezer. Physically also speaking, you can very simply express this, because the Fermi function at very low temperatures is flat, right? So we saw this diagram. We saw that this is the donor level. Right? And the Fermi function is extremely flat. If it is like this, then the probability of this being filled is very small. This being empty is very small, right? And that's the reason why you do not have ionized carriers at very low temperatures. Now let us go to very high temperatures. At this, in these positions, it's easy to see that the temperature is very large. As the temperature is very large, then the denominator is very small. So the exponent value is small. So what happens is, in this range you have Nd plus equal to Nd, right? However, you should also note that it also has to do with the Fermi function, right? So as we saw before, you have the band structure. At very low temperatures, the Fermi function is flat. This is the Fermi Dirac at very low temperatures. The Fermi Dirac at very high temperatures will look like this. Oops. It has to pass through the half point, right? And this is the Fermi Dirac at high temperature. At high T, you see that you have a lot of occupation probability here, and Nc is much higher than Nd. NC being the effective density of states, and donor, and you cannot reach 10 power 11, 12 donor density, right? 21, 22 donor densities, right? Under such conditions, your NI is much larger than ND, and in there, therefore, it actually behaves as if it is an intrinsic semiconductor. So at very high temperature, it is almost intrinsic. At very low temperatures, it's again, the doping density does not matter. So it's almost like intrinsic. And only it's in the intermediate range where you see that your N is almost equal to ND. So this explains, so this particular expression completely explains why we see this kind of a plot, right? So with this information, let's go back to our previous discussion. We are still talking about the number of carriers, N being the carrier density. And we saw that N into P at any temp is Ni square, and the intrinsic case. And even when you dope, right, let us say that if N is the, not the capital N. So this was Ni in the intrinsic case. And if N is the carrier density in the extrinsic case, similarly P being the same, N into P as per our previous discussions here, right? And remember, let me write this expression again because it's going to be important. I'm going to write N is again equal to NC e power EF minus EC by KT, right? And remember, this EF is what that changes, right? The number of effective density of states in the valence, in the conduction band, is not going to change. Your conduction energy level is not going to change. And at particular given temperature, if you dope the semiconductor and have a very different carrier density, all that is going to change according to this carrier density is the Fermi level, right? And you can very easily see that as you have your, as the N increases, you can see that your Fermi level is going to go closer and closer to the conduction band, right? So this expression tells you the behavior of Fermi level with respect to the carrier density. And if you write the N into P product even for an intrinsic extrinsic semiconductor, you will again get back the same expression minus Eg by KT, which is equal to Ni square. So this equation is called the law of mass action, which is true for an intrinsic semiconductor, for extrinsic semiconductor, and for any semiconductor per se. And this value is always going to be true. N into P is equal to Ni square. With the law of mass action given, we also know that the entire semiconductor is electrically neutral under all conditions, right? Because you know that outside the semiconductor, you don't have any potential, and hence it has to be electrically neutral. And hence, the number of electrons, which is negatively charged, plus the acceptors, ionized acceptors, which are negatively charged, should be equal to the number of holes plus the number of ionized donors. This is charge neutrality condition. With these two given, right, you can actually derive that, because we previously derived the expressions for electrons, number of electrons, and the number of holes, you can write that N is equal to half under any situation, Nd plus minus Na minus plus root of Nd plus minus Na minus square plus 4 Ni square. I encourage you to go and derive this expression. It's very straightforward. You just require these two and the previous equations that we derive, right? And if If we say, if we have ND plus much larger than NA minus, right? You dope it only or mostly with donors and with not much of acceptors, and such that the temperature is such that it is also much larger than NI. Right? Under such situations, you know that N is almost equal to ND plus, and P is equal to NI square. This is pretty straightforward. And N will be equal to ND plus, which is be equal to NC e power EF minus EC by KT. Right? And you also know this NI equal to NC e power. The Fermi level of the intrinsic semiconductor is typically expressed by this term EI, because in the previous case we saw that EI is equal to EC plus EV by 2 plus a very small number, and it is mostly equal to EC plus EV by 2. The Fermi level for an intrinsic semiconductor is written as EI. Now with this given, you can actually express this as NI. If you divide one by the other, you will get this e power EF minus EI by KT. One can go back and derive the same set of expressions for holes as well, which will turn out to be EI minus EF by KT. So these are very important expressions which will let us to either get the Fermi level given the doping density or the doping density given the Fermi level. And it is typically in the experimental side, you typically have a fair feeling for the doping density and then you want to know what the Fermi level is. But in certain situations, you know what is the Fermi level because you have applied some potential, and then you can estimate what is the actual carrier density in the material. So with these important expressions, we stop this current treatise, and then we will deal with carrier dynamics the next time we meet. Thank you.